Hello friends, today we are going to discuss about hedging strategies using futures contracts. What is hedging? Purpose of any hedger is to use futures market to reduce a particular risk which they are facing. As a hedger, a person usually already have a position in the market for that asset. For example, somebody already owns that asset or is going to own that asset in near time in future, and he wants to cover the risk of fluctuation in prices. For that purpose, he wants to have a position in the futures market for, to create a riskless portfolio for his assets. So basically, purpose of hedging is to reduce the risk. A perfect hedge would be something where, you are able to eliminate the risk completely, which is usually rare. So hedging using futures contract is a study of ways in which hedges can be constructed so that they perform as close to perfect as possible. Basically, aim of any hedger is to neutralize the risk. So initially, when derivative instruments were launched in India, the purpose was was hedging only. So that the risk of those people who want to reduce their risk can be eliminated. So one very important feature of futures and options is to create a hedge or to create a riskless returns on the portfolio or on the assets which somebody has. Now there can be two kinds of hedging positions. One is short hedge and long hedge. So short hedge is a hedge that involves short position in futures contract. That means you want to have a sell position in the futures contract. This situation is appropriate when the hedger already owns the asset and expect to sell it sometime in future. So somebody who already has a position in the asset, that means he already owned that asset or is going to own that asset in near time in future. So in that case, you would like to sell the futures contract to create a hedge. Or it can be used when an asset is not owned right now, but will be owned sometime in future. For example, there's a farmer who wants to sell his wheat crop in future. So in that case, he knows that his produce will be available for sale in near time. So he can have a short position in futures contract. He can sell a futures contract, where he promises to sell the underlying asset at a future date, at a future price. Thus, he is able to protect himself from the risk of loss of prices in future. There can be an exporter who knows that he will receive euros after 3 months. So, exporter will gain if euros increase in value relative to the US dollar. Now, in case there are prices of euros that are fluctuating with respect to US dollar, so he is not sure that after 3 months the euros he is going to get, whether he'll be able to get it at the price at which US dollar is priced today, or will it be some other price. So as an exporter, he will earn a profit if euros increase in value relative to US dollar in future, but he will incur a loss if euros decrease in value relative to the dollar. So he can have a perception, he can have an idea that, he will have a short position in the futures contract and thus able to cover his risk of loss of prices or risk of reduction in prices because of US dollar euro exchange rate. Let's take an example here. Today is 15th of May. Let's assume there's an oil producer who has negotiated a contract to sell 1 million barrel of crude oil. Now the price of crude oil is agreed is the market price. How much crude oil he wants to sell? 1 million barrel. Now the price is agreed is the market price on August 15. So 3 months from now, he is ready to sell 1 million barrel of crude oil. Now he's an oil producer and he already has oil. So he wants to hedge his position that, what will happen in future if the price of crude oil changes. Now suppose stock spot price. Spot price means that in the commodities market, what is the price of that oil, crude oil in the future, in the spot market on 15th of May is $60 per barrel. Now today's price is $60 per barrel. And crude oil futures in New York Mercantile Exchange for August delivery is $59 per barrel. Now futures contract is available at 59. So today he can sell in the market at $60, but August delivery crude oil futures are available at $59 per barrel for each contract of 1000 barrel. So that means to cover up a position for 1 million barrel, he needs to buy 1000 futures contract, because one contract is worth 1000 barrel quantity. So as a company, he can hedge by shorting 1000 futures. So he will buy 1000 short hedge or short future contracts, sell future contracts for August delivery. Now we have to see, we have to compare that whether he has earned a profit or loss on August 15, on the day when he is actually selling oil in the market, and then he is also closing down his future contract in the market. Now suppose the spot price on August 15 is 55 per barrel. So actually he has to sell oil to some of the vendor, which he will sell for $55 million of oil under his sales contract. So his sales revenue from the buyer company is $55 per barrel. Now usually what happens at the time of maturity or at the time of expiry of futures contract, the spot price gets very close to the futures price. Now what is his gain? So his gain is, if you look at how much he has gained in this contract. So his gain is $59 is the futures price at which he entered into the contract. So it is future price F1, spot price at expiry S1. So let's say spot price at expiry is $55. So his future contract, if he sells, says that he can sell something at $59 as compared to the market price, which is $55. So in the futures market, he is earning a profit of $4 per barrel. So future price in August minus the spot price is the profit from the short position. So in the actual market, so how much company has earned? He has earned $55 plus he has also earned $4 from the futures market. Now this profit he has got from futures market. And this profit he has got from sales. So this is his sales revenue. Now suppose oil price on August 15 is $65 per barrel. Now what happens if the price is not $55 but the price is $65 per barrel? Now in that case what happens? In the actual market he is able to sell oil for $65. So $65 is his selling price and $59 is his futures price. So in the futures market what happens? He is able to sell futures for $59, but actual market price of oil right now is $65. So in the futures market he has incurred a loss of $6 per barrel. So how much ultimately he realizes from a futures contract or from the overall transaction? $65 is his sales and $6 is his futures market loss. So ultimately he is able to earn $59 only. And let's talk about long hedges. Long hedge is a position where you have a buy position in the futures market. Now this is appropriate when a company knows that it will have to purchase some asset in future and wants to lock the price today, right? So you are going to get that asset in future, or you're going to, want to lock the price for it today, that's why you are entering into a long hedge contract. Now suppose on 15th Jan, there's a copper fabricator and he knows that he will require 1 lakh pound of copper on 15th of May to meet a particular contract. The spot price of copper. So spot price you can say is as S0. So spot price as on today is 340 cents per pound. And futures price for May delivery. So futures price which they have decided as on today's contract is 320 cents per pound. And one contract for futures is available for 25,000 pounds copper contract size. So that means to cover up 1 lakh, he has to buy 4 such contracts. So 25,000 into 4, he has to buy 4 such contracts to complete his 1 lakh, to create a hedge for 1 lakh pound of copper, which he's actually going to buy on 15th of May. Now a question may arise to your mind that why he has to enter into a futures contract. He can, if he knows that today's copper price is 340 cents, he can buy it today itself and keep it in his stock. Why he is worried about that, what will happen to the prices if the price go unfavorable in future. So the idea is that if he will buy copper today for the contract which he has to fulfill on 15th of May, what will happen that he will have to bear the storage cost of copper and his money will be blocked. So that is why he preferred that whenever he'll have to fulfill that contract on 15th of May, then only he will buy. But he also doesn't want to lose on the profit or doesn't want to have on an unfavorable position at that time, depending upon, you know, what will be the price of copper in the month of May. So that is why he wants to enter into the forward futures contract. Now let's see. Now suppose the price of copper on 15th of May is 325 cents. So now what happens? There's a spot price S0 which was $340. Then there is a spot price on expiry on 15th of May which is, let's say, $325. Right? And then there's a future price for the contract, right, which was decided as 320. So these are the three information which is available to us. Now suppose the spot price of copper on 15th of May is 325 cents per pound. How much the fabricator will earn? Now he has to purchase copper, so he'll have to pay a price. So he has to actually pay a price for the copper, which is 325 multiplied by 1 lakh contract which he has to buy, and that is the actual purchase cost. Apart from that, he earns a profit from the futures contract. Why? Because the future contract said that the long future price will be 320 and the actual price of copper is 325. So he is earning a profit from the futures contract. He is able to save 5 cents per pound pound of copper. So he makes a profit of $5,000, which will be added to his DMAT margin account. Now he actually pays 1 lakh into 3.25 cents for buying the copper in the spot market. So that is an outflow from his account, and $5,000 is added to his account. So net cost which he has incurred comes out to be 3,20,000 as a net cost in his bank account. Now let's assume that instead of spot price being 325, it is 305. So let's say spot price goes to 305. Now what happens? In the futures market, he has, bought to buy the futures contract for 320. spot price is 305. So practically he is getting a loss of 15 cents per pound from the futures market as well. So his loss in the futures market is 15,000. So that 15,000 will be deducted from his margin account. So something worth 305, he is buying at 320. So 15,000 is the loss. He is actually able to purchase. So his sales will be, his purchase price will be, he will purchase it at the price of 305. And 15,000 is the loss on the futures contract. So ultimately, his cost is 320 cents per pound. So in this way, in the futures contract, when you try to hedge your position with the help of future contract, you are able to lock a price. Now this price locking is 320. So he is able to lock a price of 320. So whether whatever happens to the spot price in future, whether the price goes up or down, it goes to 325 or it goes to 305, if you buy a futures contract in whichever long hedge or a short hedge position, you are able to lock a price for yourself. That is 320, let's say in this case. So your net profit or loss in your bank account would be 320, whatever be the spot price. And so you have a realistic understanding of that you have locked a price in the month of January only for yourself, that what at what price you will buy copper from the market. So how do you create a long and a short hedge? A long futures hedge is appropriate when you know that you will purchase an asset in the future and you want to lock the price today. A short future hedge is appropriate. Short future means you are selling futures. Is appropriate when you know that you will sell an asset in the future and want to lock the price today. Now, hedging is a double-edged sword. It can help you minimize the risk from interest rate fluctuation and exchange rate fluctuation and other business variables. But there are, as a double-edged sword, it has its own limitations, because the shareholders are usually well diversified and they can take their own hedging decisions. So as a company who owns certain asset, you need not create a hedge for yourself, because unnecessarily creating double hedge would not give you any extra returns from the market. It may increase the risk to hedge when competitors do not. Now let's take this example of this copper fabricator only. He locked the price. Let's say the manager who's taking this decision of creating a hedge, he has locked a price for himself for 320 cents of buying the copper. Now there may be other competitors in the market who are buying copper in the month of May. Let's say if they are not into hedging, they are not into taking future position, so they will buy it from the actual market. So in case the spot price goes to 325, so other competitors are buying copper at 325 and you are buying copper at 320 because you have entered into a hedging agreement of futures. So your company will incur a profit of 5,000. Now let's say if the market price goes to 305. So in that case, what happens that the other competitors of yours have purchased copper in the month of May at 305 cents. But you are purchasing copper at 320 because that is the net price which you are paying for it. So in that case, it will become very difficult for you as a manager to justify your seniors or the top management that why a loss of 15,000 pounds you have incurred, or why a loss of 15 cents you have incurred where your competitors. So you are unnecessarily creating a loss for yourself in case the situation goes unfavorable to you. So whenever you are into a situation where there is a loss on hedge, it becomes very difficult for you as a manager who has taken this decision of entering into the futures market because the top management would say, what was the need of getting into such a scenario? Now, there's a concept that says that, you know, futures prices converge to the spot price. So initially, at time period zero, when we enter into a futures contract, the spot price is different from the futures price, and usually it is lower than the futures price. Now, as we move to the toward expiry, so let's say at T2 time, the expiry is going to happen. So as the time passes, as the contract reaches near to the maturity, you will find that the futures price try to converge to the spot price, because you know one is able to predict more realistically that what are going to be the prices. Now, the difference between the spot price and the future price is known as basis. So this is the risk which we are trying to cover. So basis is the difference between the spot price and the future price. So this basis risk arises because of uncertainty about the basis when the hedge is closed out. Like when an asset whose price is to be hedged may not be exactly the same as underlying the futures contract, then there can be a basis risk that can arise. When a hedger is uncertain about the exact date when the asset will be bought or sold, or when the hedger may have closed out before its delivery month, so you will find that the basis or the basis risk is not fully covered in the contract. So basis is the difference between the spot price and the futures price. So spot price of the asset to be hedged minus the future price of the contract used. If the asset to be hedged and the underlying asset is same, the basis should be zero at the time of expiry of future contract. Prior to expiry, basis can be positive or negative. As time will pass, the spot price and the future price do not necessarily change by the same amount. So you will find at different time periods, at different point of time, basis risk is different. Whenever basis increases, we call it as strengthening of the basis. And whenever there is a decrease in basis, it is known as weakening of the basis. These are the notations used. S1 is treated as spot price at the time period T1, at the time of entering the contract. S2 is the spot price at the time period T2, that is at the time of expiry. F1 is the future price at time period T1 in the beginning. F2 is the future price at the time of expiry of the contract. B1 is basis at the time T1, at the time of entering the contract. And B2 is the basis at the time period T2. So the formula of B1 is S1 minus F1, and B2 basis at the time of expiry is S2 minus F2. Let's take another example. Now the spot price and the futures price at the time when the hedge is initiated, spot price at that time is $0.25 and futures price at that time is $2.2. So basis would be, B1 would be 2.5 minus 2.2, that is 0.30. Spot price at expiry is given as $2. Future price at expiry is 1.90. So basis at the time of expiry is 0.10. Now let's say you are a hedger who knows that the asset will be sold at time period T2. So at that time you will have you already have that asset and you will sell it at time period T2. So you take a short position in the futures contract today. So for you, the sales receipt or the total inflow at the time of expiry would be the price realized for the asset. Actually, in the spot market you will sell that asset and you will receive some money, and there will be some profit in the futures position. So whatever is the difference between the two futures prices, F1 minus F2, that will be your profit. So the effective price that is obtained at the time of expiry is S2, that that is the price you realize, plus difference between the two future prices. Or we can also write this equation as F1 plus basis. So 2, that is the actual spot price for which you are selling the asset, plus 2.2 future price at expiry, at the beginning, minus future price at expiry. So it is $2.30 is your net inflows at the time of expiry. So as a seller, if you realize that at the time of expiry, spot price is higher than the futures price, you will gain. If value of future price, let's say in this equation, if this value is known to you, F1 is known to you, and B2 is known to you, so you can create a perfect hedge for yourself. But usually these are not known, so we are not able to create a perfect hedge for ourselves. Now let's take the situation for a long hedge. You hedge the asset in the future. So you hedge the future purchase of an asset by entering into a long future contract. So the second scenario can be that a company knows that the asset will be bought at the time of expiry, so they can enter into a long hedge today. Now, how much would be the cost they will incur? Spot price, that is the actual price which they will pay, minus the profit or loss from the futures market, so F2 minus F1. So F1 plus basis will give you this answer. So you'll incur a loss of, on the hedge, in this scenario, F2 minus F1. So his net price would be 2.30 only. So as a buyer, if T2 spot price is there, it is higher than F2 futures price, so he will incur losses. Now this basis risk, which is the difference between spot price and the futures price, so this can lead to improvement or worsening of a hedge's position. So in case of a short hedge, if the basis will strengthen, that means S2 minus F2 increases. So hedge's position is going to improve. If the basis weakens, that means there's a decrease in S2 minus F2 decreases, hedge's position will worsen. So long hedges, if basis strengthen, hedger position will worsen in case, he'll have losses. And the basis will weaken, if the basis weakens, hedger will gain in case of a long position. Now, at the time, as we said, that, you know, a perfect hedge cannot be created or basis risk cannot be avoided completely because of different reasons. Now, these reasons can be in case the underlying asset is different. So, in case the asset that gives rise to hedge's exposure to something different from the underlying asset, it increases the basis risk. Now, it can be possible. Let's say that you want to have a hedge as a company, you want to create a hedge position for futures contract on oil. And let's say in the commodity market, there are no future contract which are available for oil. In the commodity spot market, oil is there. Now you will have to buy any other asset which is similar to oil. So you will create a hedge for yourself with another asset which looks like or whose behavior is like oil. Then you will take into consideration that asset spot price. So they define it with the help of a term S2 star. So this S2 star means it is the price of the asset underlying the future contract at the price T2. Now S2 can be a price of the asset which is hedged at T2. So there is a spot price of one asset, and then there's a asset which you have for which you have created a hedge in the futures contract. So that is that asset spot price is treated as S2 star. Now by hedging the company, it is ensuring that the price will be paid or received for the asset at the time of maturity or at the time of expiry. So spot price for the underlying asset plus future price in the beginning minus future price at the end. Or this can also be written as future price in the beginning plus spot price of the other asset minus F2 plus the difference between the two spot prices, because that difference will also, you know, create a risk or component of basis. So this S2 star minus F2 is the basis that would exist if the asset being hedged is same as the underlying asset. Now S2 minus S2 star is the basis which is arising from the difference between these two assets. Now this basis can also arise based on the choice of contract, or basis is that the difference, why there will be a difference between the risk you are not able to cover fully with the help of hedge. In case you want to buy or sell the underlying asset which you already have a position in on, let's say, 10th date of a month, future contracts expire near to end of the month, last Thursday of the month in India. So what you are going to do, you should choose a delivery month. So what should be your delivery month? If your asset you are going to sell in the real market on 10th of the month, should you choose a contract which is previous to that month, or should you choose to a contract which is finishing or expiring the next month? So one should choose a delivery month that is as close as possible to, but later than, the end of the life of the hedge. So it should be afterwards. The futures contract should finish afterwards. Basis risk will increase as the time difference between the hedge expiry and delivery month increases. So when there are no future contract on the asset which is being hedged, choose the contract whose future price is mostly highly correlated with the asset price. Then there are two components to this. Let's take this example. A US company is to receive 50 million Japanese yen at the end of July. In Chicago Mercantile Exchange, one contract is for 12.5 million yen. Now what the company will do to match 50 million? The company shorts 4 September yen contract on 1st of March. When company will receive yen in July, it closes out its position. So future price in the beginning is 0.78 cents per yen. Spot price at expiry is 0.70. Future price at expiry is 0.7250. The gain is future price in the beginning minus future price at the end, so 0.055 cents per yen. Now here, because spot price is less than the future price, so you will see that the seller has gained some money from the futures market. Now the basis is spot price minus future price when the contract is closed out. So the effective price which is obtained in cents per yen is the final spot price plus the gain on futures. So S2 plus F1 plus F2. So you'll get 0.7750, or you can calculate it as initial future price plus the basis, 0.78 plus B2. So the amount received by the company is, because there were 50 million Japanese yen, into 0.0075. So this is the final figure of the amount which the company receives. Let's take another example. It is June 8 and a company knows that it needs to purchase 20,000 barrels of crude oil in October or November. Oil futures are available in every month and contract size is 1,000 barrels. Company decide December as the month and take long position in 20 December contracts. Future price in the beginning is $68 per barrel. It closes out on November 10. Spot price at the expiry is $70 per barrel. Future price at expiry is $69.1 per barrel. So if you have to calculate basis at the end, right? So it is S2 minus F2. So 0.90. Gain in the long future, how much is the gain in the long future? It is the difference between F1 and F2. So 1.1. So effective price which is paid by this company is the spot price at expiry minus the difference between, we gain from the futures contract. So 68.90 is the effective price which is paid by the company. There is a concept of cross-hedging. Cross-hedging is possible when there are two assets and like we have a spot asset in the spot market and we have an asset in the futures market. Now, if these two assets are different, so in that case, and we want to create a hedge for the underlying asset, so such a hedge is known as a cross hedge. For example, an airlines want futures on jet fuel. But let's say in the mercantile exchange, there are no futures which are available on jet fuel. Now, they will choose any product or any commodity which behaves similar to jet fuel. So they may choose heating oil futures to hedge their exposure. Now, since the base price of both these future contracts, so jet fuel is available in the spot market, it is available in the futures market, is not available in the futures market. Heating oil is available in the spot market as well as available in the futures market. Now, if an airline company wants to create a hedging strategy for jet fuel, now there will be some difference between the spot price at the time of expiry of jet fuel and the heating oil, as well as there will be difference between. So in that case, how many contracts should be taken? So that is decided on the basis of hedge ratio. So hedge ratio is the ratio of the position taken in futures contract to the size of exposure. When asset underlying the futures contract is the same as the asset being hedged, you will find that the hedge ratio is equal to 1. Whenever cross-hedging is done, setting hedge ratio equal to 1 is not always possible. So, hedger should choose a value from the hedge ratio that minimizes the variance of the value of hedged position. How do we calculate optimal hedge ratio? So, H is calculated as, if you are going to choose underlying asset and an asset for which future contract is available, how will you select that, which asset you have to choose? You will choose it on the basis of coefficient of correlation. So two assets which are highly correlated, they are the one which you should choose in terms of mapping their historical prices. So this rho is the coefficient of correlation between delta change in spot price and the change in future price. And sigma S is the standard deviation of change in spot price during the hedging period. And sigma F is the standard deviation of changes in futures price during the hedging period. So standard deviation of spot divided by standard deviation of future price multiplied with coefficient of correlation, you will get a ratio. This ratio will help you decide how many contracts to purchase. So those values which are highly correlated, they should be taken up. Now, how many contracts should be purchased in case there is cross-hedging done, in case the underlying asset and the asset for which the future contract has been purchased or the spot contract is available are different? So there are two ways of determining number of contracts which you can decide. One, we can compare the exposure to be hedged with the value of asset underlying one future contract, or we can compare the exposure to be hedged with the value of one futures contract. And the second approach incorporates the adjustment of daily settlement future values. So N, that means number of contracts to be hedged, is decided on the basis of hedge ratio multiplied with value of the underlying asset divided by value of the futures contract for which the futures are available. Now, in case there are index futures and you want to create a cross hedge for index futures, so in that case, instead of hedge ratio, we take the value beta. Now, beta is the risk, the systematic risk of the market. So that can also be taken for calculating the hedge ratio. So VA is the current value of the portfolio, VF is the current value of one futures contract. For example, the future price of S&P 500 is 1010. Size of portfolio is given to you as $5,05,000,000. beta of the portfolio is 1.5. One contract is $1,250 times the index, and S&P's today's price or spot price at time period 0 is 1000. Risk-free rate of return is given as 4% per annum or 1% per 3 months. Dividend yield on the index is also given 1% per annum or 0.25 for 3 months. Now, if you have to calculate, you will first calculate that, you know, what is the value of the future contract. So, 250 into 1010. Now, for calculating the number of future contract to be shorted, you will take the beta 1.5 multiplied by the value of the contract divided by the future value of the contract. This will give you that you should short 30 contracts. Now, what will happen to the spot price at the time of expiry? Let's say after 3 months, index goes 900 and the future price is 902. So, what is the gain on the short position? 30 into 1010, that was the future contract price that was decided, minus 902 multiplied with 250. So, this is the gain in the short position. But there is a loss on the index because there is 10% reduction in the price. And if dividend is taken into account, so 0.25% is the dividend for 3 months. So, index would earn minus 10 plus 25, minus 9.75 in 3 months. Expected return, if you have to calculate, so it is risk-free rate of return plus beta into market risk premium. So, 1 plus 1.5 minus 9.75 minus 1. So, minus 15% is the expected return on this portfolio. Okay. Now, there's also a concept called rolling the hedge forward. What is rolling the hedge forward? Sometimes it can be possible that you are going to procure, or the seller is going to sell the underlying asset in the spot market after, let's say, 8 months or after a certain time period, future, and you want to create a hedge. In futures market, the contract is available maximum for 3 months. So, if it is for 8 months, so you will buy one contract for 3 months, then you should buy another contract for another 3 months after that one, the first one expires, and after that you should buy another contract for 2 months. That is how you will be able to map all 8 months, you will be able to map your, cover your risk for 8 months. So this process of shifting from one future contract to another future contract so that you are able to cover your risk is known as rolling the hedge forward. So, we can use series of futures contract to increase the life of the hedge. But what happens each time we switch from one future contract to another, we incur a type of basis risk. So, in that case, 100% risk coverage will not be there because of the basis which changes when we change from one contract to another contract. So, each contract will have its own kind of basis risk, which will remain in terms of covering your hedge. So there will not be a perfect hedge, but yes, to maximum possible extent, you will be able to cover your risk. Thank you.